Thanks so much for being here for this training today. You know what, as you receive this training in safety and how to use tools, we know it's going to help you go and make a difference in these homeowners' lives. No better time to be salt and light, no better time to be the hands and feet of Jesus, no better time to preach the gospel, not by words, but by our actions, than right now during this hurricane recovery effort. You know what, together we're better, and we as a Lakewood family, we're committed for the long haul to help our city recover. God bless you, and have a great day.
Hi guys, we'd just like to tell you that we're so thankful for you volunteering today.
But most of all, we want to make sure that you do it right and keep your family safe while you're helping rebuild Houston.
This is Lance Sheffield here. I'm with my family, and we're also part of the Lakewood family.
It's very important to volunteer as a family. I'm Kira, my age is 16.
I'm Danielle, I'm 15.
My name's Aiden, and I'm 14 years old.
And the restrictions are 14 to 17 with the guardian.
So first things first, I'd like to talk about personal safety, and I'd like to probably start with safety glasses, which are very important. Get yourself a pair of safety glasses. You're going to want a dust mask. So you're going to start by taking the bottom strap, and you're going to put it over your head towards the back of your neck. And then you're going to take the top strap, and you're going to put it over your head, right above your ears, and then press firmly on the metal strip against your nose, and that will create a nice tight seal. Guys, what you don't want to do is have a beard, because that will not keep the mask tight to your face.
And make sure that you don't have any hair inside of the mask.
That will prevent the contaminants from getting in.
Okay, so the next thing we're gonna wanna do, guys, after you put your mask and your safety glasses on, is let's go ahead and put on a pair of gloves. And it's probably a good idea to have a good set of heavy-duty gloves. You're going to be picking up a lot of
debris,
sheetrock. It's going to have a lot of nails in it. I would advise steel-toed boots, which these are actually steel-toed boots, so they're very durable. No open-toed shoes like sandals.
What you don't want to do is have a pair of tennis shoes that are mesh-like.
Put on a pair of jeans. I know it's hot here in Houston. This will definitely prevent any type of nails from cutting your legs or when you're carrying debris outside. I would also say it would be a good idea to put on a long sleeve shirt, but again, I know it's hot here. I'm wearing a t-shirt today and I'm just gonna be extra careful. So after you're all geared up and you've got your safety equipment all on, what we're gonna do is we're going to tackle the baseboard, the window trim, the door trim, and we're also going to take off outlet plate covers, which I'll show you how to do right now. It's very easy. You're just gonna need a flat head screwdriver. You're just gonna go ahead and unscrew it, and then just take that off. You might wanna save those. So another important thing before you take these cover plates off is to make sure that the entire house, the power is turned off. So you're gonna wanna go ahead and go to your breaker and turn the main switch off. Just like to show you how you're going to take the baseboard and trim off, even though that the baseboard and the trim has been taken off in this house already, you can basically understand it. I'll show you how to do that right now. So what we're going to do is the baseboard primarily butts down to the flooring or the tile, and what you're going to do is you're going to take your flat bar, you're going to put it at the top, and then you're going to hit down, relieve that little edge, and then just pry that off, and that will take that baseboard right off. Very easy. Same thing with the door trim. What you're gonna do is just get your flat bar edge right at the edge of the trim, and you're just gonna tap the flat bar right behind there, get a good edge, and then pry it up and off. Next order of business is we're going to take the sheetrock off the walls, and the sheetrock's gonna be very wet, and perhaps even moldy at that point. So just make sure that you do have your mask on, your safety goggles, your gloves, and it might even be a good idea to put on a pair of nitrile gloves or latex gloves underneath your heavy duty gloves, just to prevent your gloves from getting soaking wet. So it's important to know where the flooding is in your home. And a good idea, it's very simple. You can see the water line on your walls, on your doors, etc. So what we're gonna do is, let's just say the water line in this house was at 3 feet, okay? Here's 3 feet. If that's where the water line was, you're gonna wanna take the sheetrock off up another 12 inches. So here, they've already taken the sheetrock off at 4 feet. Each sheet of sheetrock is 4 feet tall, or 4 feet wide, by 8 feet long. So we can fit a full piece of sheetrock right back in this space after it's been removed. one easy way to take the sheetrock off. In this case, I'm going to go ahead and just measure up 4 feet, make a line, go over to the other side of the wall, up 4 feet, make another line. We're going to take a chalk line, and what this does, puts a straight line on the wall so you have a nice straight line to cut. Put the line at 4 feet, put the line at 4 feet. We're just going to go ahead and we're going to snap it, and that creates a nice straight line for you to cut. So there's two ways to cut the sheetrock after you've snapped your chalk line, and one way in particular is with a sawzall. This tool can be pretty dangerous if you're not familiar with it, so I'm advising you, unless you've used this before, to talk to your team leader. If you feel uncomfortable about using it, then please do not use it. The other tool we have right here is a box cutter,
and it's very easy to use. You just press down and push forward.
So, just about to cut the sheetrock, and another good point I just want to make as far as a safety point is there's lots of wires in these walls, so you have to be very careful when you're going to be cutting this sheetrock. So you don't want to plunge this blade in all the way, because what will happen is, number one, you'll cut these wires, and number two, you'll cut these studs, and that's not a good idea. So what we're going to do is we're just going to keep the blade very shallow, just like that, and you can cut the sheetrock very easily.
So the other way is to use a box cutter. And you're simply going to trace along the chalk line, push in, and just keep pulling it towards yourself.
After removing the trim and the sheetrock and the baseboards, you're going to have a lot of nails left over. So what you're going to need to do is we're going to have to pull all the nails and screws out. So
when you get a little lower to the ground, it's a good idea to turn your hammer the other way around.
There's also going to be screws in the walls as well, so we're going to take these out from the sheetrock. So you're going to want to have a cordless drill with a Phillips head number 2 screwdriver bit on it, and we're just going to back it out just like that. Make sure that you throw all your screws and your nails in contractor bags and take them out and make sure that they're piled in different sections on your sidewalk. Okay, so next step is we're going to remove the insulation. Now the insulation is going to be very wet and soggy, so just make sure that you have your nitrile or latex gloves underneath your heavy duty gloves. It will definitely help you out in the long run. So what we're going to do is just go ahead and pull down the insulation from the wall cavity. Very easy. Okay. And then we're going to just roll it up. And we're just going to get it right in a contractor bag. That's good. All right, so we're gonna go ahead and after you've removed the insulation, we're gonna just clean these bays out. These have already been cleaned, but I'll show you how to do it. It's very easy. Just do a nice job, and you're just gonna wanna just sweep out everything that you can. If you have a wet and dry vac, that's a great idea. It makes very quick work of this. So next step, after you've cleaned out the bays, what we're gonna do is we're gonna spray a mold inhibitor. It's very easy to do. So what you're gonna do is each mold inhibitor has its own type of application. This one, in fact, has 2 ounces per 2 gallons. So what we're going to do is just pour 2 ounces into this spray pump. We're going to put 2 ounces in here with a mold inhibitor. And then we're going to fill this up to 2 gallons. We're going to put the top back on. Okay. Give it a good pump to get it pressurized, okay? And then what you're going to do is just survey the area of the walls where you've noticed if there is mold. What you're going to want to do is just spray up a little higher than that all around in all these bays. Do not use Clorox bleach. It is not effective on remediating mold.
If the family's personal belongings have gotten wet, it's really important to remove them. Keeping things like furniture and their personal belongings that have been contaminated with the water from the flood, which could be sewer water and a lot of other contaminants. It can cause health conditions and mold in the home, so it's really important to get rid of those.
It's another good idea as well to be careful when going up into a closet and you can't see. Just be careful. There could be snakes, there could be spiders. You never know. So lastly, What we're going to do is remove any type of wet carpet or wet flooring, and we're going to roll up the carpet and we're going to take it outside and put it in a specific spot on the sidewalk. The same goes for wet flooring as well.
So when you're bringing the contractor bags out to the sidewalk, what we have right here, this is the right way to do it, okay? You want to pile everything in one big pile. You've got doors over here in a separate pile. You've got furniture here in another pile. It makes it a lot easier for when they come and they pick up the trash. After you're done and you're about to head home, take your boots, because they're definitely going to be contaminated, and put them in a garbage bag. That way when you get home, you can clean them off. Another good thing I want to mention too is in the whole process, you're going to be dealing with a lot of contaminants, so it's a good idea to always just be washing your hands. I know it's hot out, guys. This is Houston. Right before you go to take a drink of water, just make sure that your hands are clean, or just use hand sanitizer. It's just a great way to prevent any type of disease.
It's so meaningful for you to come out today and help those in need.
So Lakewood Rebuild will give each family a Bible. The Bible will be signed by everybody that helped out in the process.
Make sure you always have a smile on your face. Right, honey?
That's right.
You are representing Lakewood Church, and Lakewood Church always helps those in need.